be with you, right? And thank you all very much for coming out on the beautiful afternoon. And let me thank Eric Heike of Friends of the Earth, one of the great environmental organizations, not only in the United States, but internationally. These guys are doing a great job, and I very much appreciate the endorsement of Friends of the Earth. If we were here 4 months ago, not very long time ago, it's been a long time, but not such a long time. And somebody had said, you know, you're going to run for president, but what I'm going to say is, I really don't know. Mike is not enthusiastic about the company. Smart lady, she is. And there are a lot of impediments, a lot of challenges. But about 3 months ago, only 3 months ago, we made the decision to run. And in 3 months, when we began, a lot of friends in the media said, well, he's a nice guy, he's a smart guy, he's a fringe candidate. Because nobody in America really believes in the ideas that Bernie Sanders believes in. He's too radical. The message will not resonate. Well, a lot has happened. Happen on the way to a coronation. Elizabeth pointed out, we have been drawing huge crowds, not only the largest turnouts here in the Hampshire and in Iowa, but in California and Texas, in Minnesota, Minneapolis, Denver, in Las Vegas, South Carolina, Dallas. We decided something that I believe very strongly, that if the Democratic Party is a serious party, it has to be a political party in 50 states, not 25 states. We were in Dallas, Texas. I generally thought to be the hotbed of progressivism. We had 8,000 people out in Dallas. We had 5,200 people out in Houston. We had 11,000 people out in Phoenix. And in the not too distant future, we're going to be going to Alabama, Mississippi, South Carolina.
Yeah!
My very strong view that where people do not have health insurance, where people do not have jobs, where people are earning starvation wages, where children are hungry, that is where we should be. What has been really exciting about this campaign, it's not just the large turnouts like what we have here today, but the kind of grassroots activism that is taking place. You're looking at the only major candidate for president of the United States that does not have, will not have, does not want a super PAC. Very hard decision about which side I was on. And I was not on the side of Wall Street or corporate America. I don't want their money.
Yeah.
Just overwhelmed and so appreciative of the fact that we have now some 300,000 Americans who have made individual campaign contributions to the campaign. 300,000. An idea of who those people are, the average contribution is less than $35. We get contributions, we get rumpled up $5 bills from senior citizens who are struggling on Social Security. And that $5 bill needs a great deal. We have received more individual contributions than any other campaign. That's pretty good. As you know, just on Wednesday night, we did something that, as I understand it, was unprecedented in American political history, that for a campaign in this early stage of the campaign, we had organizing events in 3,700 locations in 50 states of America with over 100,000 people in attendance. And when people ask me, they say, well, why are you gaining so much enthusiasm? Why is there so much interest in your campaign? My answer is that the American people are sick and tired of establishment politics.
Yeah.
They are sick and tired of establishment economics. Yeah. And they are sick and tired of establishment media. Yeah. The American people understand instinctually, I think, that corporate greed is destroying our country, is destroying the lives of millions of working people. They understand that politics in America is now controlled to a very significant degree by the billionaire class, who spend unlimited sums of money. And they understand that mainstream media talks about everything except the most important issues facing us. I'm going to be as clear and as sincere as I can be. This campaign is not about Bernie Sanders. It is not about Hillary Clinton. It's not about Jeb Bush, it is not even about Donald Trump. This campaign is about you, it's about your kids, it's about your parents. As Eric indicated a moment ago, it is about the future of our planet. Yeah. I go out on the campaign trail just an hour or two ago and ask to attack Hillary Clinton. I don't do it. Because I believe that, and I say this as somebody who's never won a negative political ad in my life. What we have got to do is not make this a personal conflict, not make it a soap opera, but make it a campaign which focuses on the enormous problems facing our country. Woo! That's what I'm going to try to do, but it's not easy. It really is not easy. That's not exactly what media wants. But we are going to stay on message. We are going to talk about the issues of concern to the middle class and working families of our country. Now, the other point that I want to make is that I believe I am the only candidate for president who will tell you this, is that no candidate, not Bernie Sanders, not anybody else, no matter how decent, good, smart that person may be, will be able to address and solve in a significant way the enormous problems facing our country unless there is a political revolution. That means, so, that we need tens of millions of people from coast to coast to become involved in the political process in a way that we have never seen before. And the reason for it, let me be very honest with you, I happen to like Barack Obama very much as a friend. We disagree on a number of issues, but I like him and I respect him. In the year 2008, Obama ran one of the great campaigns, as you all know, in the modern history of America. It was a brilliant campaign, drowned a whole lot of people, had a huge amount of enthusiasm. The big mistake that President Obama made, right, after the religion coming from this, is that after he was elected, when he essentially said to the millions of people, he fought so hard to make history and to elect them, he said, thanks so much, but I will make it from here. I will sit down and negotiate with John Boehner, I'll sit down and negotiate with Mitch McConnell. Wrong.
Yeah!
It's not only that these guys never wanted to negotiate seriously from day one, but more significantly is the fact that in Washington right now, if you look at corporate America, if you look at the large campaign contributors, if you look at the lobbyists, if you look at Wall Street, these people have so much power that the only way a president can bring forth significant legislation if millions of people are actively behind him depending on him. The bad news is I need you not just for this campaign. I need you not only to help me get elected, I need you the day after the election as well. So we got your name, going into the computer. These guys have unlimited amounts of money, huge influence on the media. They determine what you're going to see every day on TV. They got all of that stuff. But when we stand together as millions of people fighting for working families, fighting for the middle class, guess what? We win. And our job is to stand together. Think about the major issues facing our country today. At the top of the list is the issue of income and wealth inequality.
Yes.
In my mind, this issue is the great moral issue of our time. It is the great economic issue. It is the great political issue. What we have to determine as a nation is whether or not we think it is morally acceptable that the top 0.1%, not 1%, 0.1% owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. We have to deal with it. We have to, I know how you feel, but as a nation, we have got to throw that issue on the table. Is that what this country is supposed to be about? Is America supposed to be about a situation where one family, the Walton family, owns more wealth than the bottom 40% of the world?
No!
In the last 2 years, the 14 wealthiest people in America, 14 people, not a lot of people, saw their wealth increase by $157 billion. 14 people. That is more wealth than is owned entirely by the bottom 100 130 million Americans.
Mark from the working class!
Today, well over 50% of all new income is going to the top 1%. You are living in a rigged economy where the rich get much richer, everybody else gets poorer, and together we are going to change it. To me that we are seeing a proliferation of millionaires and billionaires while the average American is working longer hours for lower wages. It is not acceptable to me that so few have so much, and disgracefully we have the highest rate of childhood poverty of any major country on earth. It is going to change. Campaign with your support is sending a simple and straightforward message to the billionaire class, and that is, you cannot have it all. You cannot get huge tax breaks when children in Vermont and New Hampshire go hungry. Our jobs to China and other low-wage countries when millions of Americans are in desperate need of work. We cannot hide billions of dollars in profits in tax havens like the Cayman Islands and Bermuda when we have enormous unmet needs in this country. You are dealing with is not just the grotesque level of income and wealth inequality. It is also the tragic reality that for the last 40 years, the great middle class of America, once the envy of the entire world, has been disappearing. And I want you all to appreciate this and to think about this. Everybody here knows that we have seen in recent years an explosion of technology, right? We all know that. Robotics, computer technology, space age technology, and all of that technology has made the average American, or anybody around the world, a far more productive worker. Our people are producing more. So you would think with all of this new technology, our people would be working fewer hours for higher wages. Well, the truth is just the opposite. People are working longer hours for lower wages. That is not the economy that the United States needs. Hell no! The reality is that since 1999, median family income, the family right in the middle of the economy, has seen its income go down by almost $5,000. In my state, and I know in your state, there are huge numbers of people not working one job, they're working two jobs, three jobs, maybe even four jobs to cobble together some income and some health care. That is not the economy we need for America. This is, after all, the wealthiest country in the history of the world, and it's time that more than a few people are able to enjoy that wealth.
about unemployment. Every month, the government comes out with a statistical official unemployment. And recently, nationally, that unemployment rate is about 5.3%, I believe it's lower here in New Hampshire and in Vermont. Officially, nationally, 5.3%. The truth is, though, there is another government statistic out there which tells you a very different tale. And what that other statistic does is include people who are working part-time where they want to work full-time. Do we all know folks who are working part-time where they want to work full-time? Okay. A lot of these out there. People who have given up looking for work. When you add all of that together, real unemployment is 10.5%. And now let me tell you something which we almost never discuss. One of the fun things about running for president of the United States is that you can push issues out there that people prefer to shove under the rug. This is an issue of enormous, enormous consequence, and there's virtually no discussion about it. Last month, my office asked the Economic Policy Institute, which is a great progressive economic think tank in Washington, and we said to them, do a study and tell us what real youth unemployment is in America. And they came out with this one. We did a lot of study, and nobody has contradicted. If you include young people, these are high school graduates between the age of 17 and 20, who are either unemployed or underemployed or given up living poor. If those kids between 17 and 20 are white, the number is 33%. If they are Hispanic, the number is 36%. If they are African American kids, the number is 51%. In other words, we are turning our backs on an entire generation of young people.
Yeah.
People who want to get out of their homes, they want a job, they want some independence, and they can't do it. And let me tell you something else. If you think that those numbers do not relate to the fact that the United States has more people in jail than any other country on earth, you will be sorely mistaken. In my state, in your state, all over this country, totally, we have about 5.5 million young people without jobs who are not in school. Now, my strong view is that rather than investing in more jails and more incarceration, maybe we should invest in education and jobs. I would like to see this country be known internationally as a nation that has the best educated population in the world, not the country with more people in jail than any other nation. And when we talk about the economy, it is not only income and wealth inequality, it is not only high unemployment, it is also the sad reality that people from coast to coast are working at wages which are totally inadequate. So let me be as clear as I can be. The federal minimum wage of 7.25 is a starvation wage. Which is why I have introduced legislation to raise the national minimum wage to $15 an hour. talk about wages and the need to raise the minimum wage, we also must talk about pay equity. It is not acceptable that women make 78 cents on the dollar. Guys, are you going to stand with the women and fight for pay equity? The simple truth is, not a very radical idea, is that if somebody works 40 hours a week, that person should not be living in poverty. Now, I know that New Hampshire sees a lot of politicians trotting through this thing, right? And some of these guys talk about family values. They just love families. And you know and I know what they mean by family values. What they mean by family values is to tell women in this country, this has everything to do with the current attacks against Planned Parenthood. Yeah. What they are telling women throughout this country is you do not have the right to control your own bodies. I strongly disagree. Women, if you can believe it, is they are not smart enough to be able to purchase the contraceptives that they need. I disagree. They are telling our brothers and sisters who are gay is that they cannot enjoy the full benefits of citizenship, cannot get married. I strongly disagree. Jane and I have been married for 27 years. We have 4 kids. We have 7 grandchildren. We believe in family values. We believe in the importance of family. But our values are a little bit different than many of my Republican colleagues. So let me tell you about some of the family values that I believe. I believe that the United States should end the international embarrassment of being the only major country on earth that does not guarantee paid family and medical care. What that means in terms of family values. Today, in New Hampshire and Vermont, women are giving birth. Now, if that woman and her family have a lot of money, or have a decent amount of money, she will be able to stay home with her baby, get to know her baby, get to love her baby. Dad will be able to stay home and be able to bond with that baby. I cannot think of anything in terms of family values that is more important than that. That woman and if that family do not have sufficient income, you know what happens to that woman? 4 days later, 6 days later, a week later, that woman must go back to work in order to earn enough money to keep her family alive. Be separated. That is not a family value. That's the opposite of a family value. That's why I believe every family in America deserves 12 weeks at least. When the pollsters go out and they call you up And they said, all right, tell me, we're doing a poll, and we kind of want to know what's on your mind, and tell them what's uppermost on your mind. Invariably, what people always say is a four-letter word called jobs. And the reason for that is they understand that the economy is very fragile. If you're an older worker, you're worried that you're going to walk into work tomorrow, and the boss will tell you, well, your job has been taken by a guy half your age at half your wages. If you're a young person, you know how hard it is to get a decent paying job. If you're working in a factory, you may walk in there and the boss says, well, I'm sorry, but your job is now in China. And that's why people are so concerned about jobs. I believe that in order to deal with the unemployment crisis in America that affects working families all across our country, we need a major federal jobs program. And the way we do that most effectively is to address the reality that our infrastructure, roads, bridges, we have got to rebuild our infrastructure, make America more efficient, productive, and safer. And when we do that, I got legislation in, $1 trillion over 5 years would create up to 13 million jobs. It's not only creating new jobs, it's making sure we do not lose the jobs that currently exist. You are looking at someone who went in the House of Representatives and in the Senate, voted against NAFTA, CAFTA, permanent normal trade relations with China. I didn't say anything about it. Why did I do that? Because I understood that all of these trade agreements were written by corporate America, not to benefit working families, but to make the very wealthy even wealthy. And the end result of all of these trade agreements has been that we have lost millions of decent paying jobs in this country because corporate America has shut down plant after plant and moved abroad. For the young people in the audience, let me tell you, I know you'll be shocked to hear this. There was once a time when you could walk into a department store and actually buy a product made in the United States. And I am determined to tell corporate America that if they want us to continue buying their products, it's high time to start building those products. Why I will continue to help lead the opposition to this TPP agreement. Yeah. TPP is a big and complicated agreement. I won't go through all of it. But according to the media, just the other day, yesterday, apparently there is a stumbling block because some of the countries understand what the pharmaceutical industry wants. And they're not going to give it to them. And what the drug companies want is to be able to prevent generics from coming on the market in a reasonable period of time. They want to extend copyright law to force not only Americans, but poor people around the world to pay sky-high prices for life-saving drugs. And that's just one element. In this country, we pay the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. They don't need to go higher. We don't need to have our workers compete against people making 56 cents an hour minimum wage. Let's defeat TPP. Yeah. Yeah. There are so many issues of huge consequence that it is always almost very hard to determine. People say, what is the most important issue? There are so many facing our country today, but this one, the issue I want to discuss briefly now, is uniquely important because it impacts every other issue. All of you are aware that some 4 or 5 years ago, by a 5-4 vote, the United States Supreme Court rendered one of the worst decisions in the history of this country. What that decision said, in so many words, is it said to the wealthiest people in this country, okay guys, you already own much of the economy, now we're going to allow you the opportunity at a bargain rate to buy the United States government. And that is what is going on right now as we speak. What we are looking at is virtually every major campaign has a super PAC. And all of these super PACs are dependent on millionaires and billionaires putting huge amounts of money into them. And you have the absurd situation where most of the campaigns will see their super PACs run by billionaires having more influence on the campaign than the candidate's own campaign. That's how crazy it is. You're looking at a situation where one family, the Koch brothers, worth some $85 billion, are prepared to spend $900 million in this campaign cycle. That is more money than either the Democratic or Republican Party will spend. When you have one family, an extreme right-wing family, that wants to end Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, the EPA, do away with the concept of a minimum wage, when you have one family spending more money than either of the two major political parties, brothers and sisters, that is not democracy. No. That is called oligarchy. Yeah. Press, I think, was picked up a number of blogs, but it was too important an issue for the national media. let me mention it soon. Earlier this week, former President Jimmy Carter was on a radio show with a friend of mine, President Carter described the United States as an oligarchy, quote, with unlimited political bribery being the essence of getting the nomination for president or to elect the president, and the same thing applies to governors in U.S. senators, end of quote. That is former President Jimmy Carter. Okay?
Right. Now,
this is an issue of such magnitude because it touches on every other issue. It touches on whether or not billionaires are able to buy politicians who work for billionaires, or whether or not we have a president and a Congress that actually work for the American people. I have made very few promises during this campaign, but here's one that I have made, and I repeat to you. No nominee of mine to the United States Supreme Court will be sent, that nomination will not be sent to the Senate unless that man or woman makes it crystal clear that he or she will make as their first order of business the overturning of citizens. It is not enough to overturn Citizens United. That's a very important first step. But in my strong opinion, if we want a vibrant democracy, what do I mean by vibrant democracy? What I mean is one not as was the case in the last election, 63% of the people didn't vote, 80% of young people didn't vote. That's not what American democracy is supposed to be about. American democracy is not supposed to be about billionaires buying elections and politicians spending three-quarters of their time hustling money for the rich. What a vibrant democracy is about is the right of anybody, regardless of his or her income, regardless of his or her political views, to be able to run for office, to talk to the people, and not have to hustle money from the wealthy. That's why we need... looks like when bright young people, again, of whatever political persuasion, conservative, moderate, progressive, when they say, you know what, I'm interested in public service. I want to be involved. I have some ideas. I can serve. And I'm not going to have to hustle money from billionaires. So public funding will revitalize American democracy. We'll have some very specific ideas as to how we move in that direction within the next. America and the great issues facing our nation. Here is one that disturbs me so much. All of us know that we live in a highly competitive global economy. And we all know that if this country is going to succeed economically, if our middle class is to grow rather than shrink, we need the best educated workforce in the world. It breaks my heart that today, hundreds of thousands of bright, qualified young people who desperately want a higher education, want to go to college, are unable to go to college for only one reason, and that is their families lack the funds. That is wrong. The working class from low-income families deserve the right to make it into the middle class. Yes. And we should not be putting out the route of success from them. But it is also absurd when we talk about the future of America. We want scientists and engineers and teachers and doctors, police officers, military people. We need the best educated workforce, and we should not have an impediment which says if you can't afford to go to college, you're not going to college. And that is why I have introduced legislation and will make happen as president to make sure that every public college and university in America is tuition free. Outrage that millions of low-income working class families today are struggling under oppressive student debt. We have young people and not so young people who are paying off huge student debts at interest of 7, 8, 9, 10%. So what I want to know is if we can refinance our homes at 2, 3%, why are we paying 9, 10% of interest? Our legislation is stupid. So one, it allows people with student debt to refinance their loans at lower interest rates. Second thing it does, what Obama did was a partially good thing. He took a lot of the student loans out of the banks who are making a fortune, but he put it into the government, which is not making a fortune. I do not believe that the United States government should be profiteering on loans that are working. Allow refinancing, getting the government out of business and making profits on student loans, we will substantially lower interest rates on student debt, and that is exactly what we should be doing. Now, there is another issue. And we just had a press conference a couple of hours ago in Concord on this, and that is the planetary crisis that we face. And that is, as adults, and as parents, there is nothing more important, in my view, than leaving this planet habitable for our kids and our grandchildren. The debate is over. Climate change is real. By human activity. Climate change is already causing devastating problems all over this planet. And what the scientists tell us is we have a small window of opportunity in order to move boldly to combat climate change by significantly transforming our energy system away from fossil fuel. Is that if we do not act boldly, if we do not transform our energy system, by the end of this century, the planet Earth will be between 5 degrees to 10 degrees Fahrenheit warm. And what that will mean is more drought, more floods, more extreme weather disturbances, more rising sea levels, more acidification of the ocean, with all of the impact that will have on marine life. And what the CIA and the Department of Defense tell us is climate change is one of the great national security issues we face. Because all over the world, if people are unable to get the water they need to survive, have land to grow their crops, they're going to migrate. And you'll have different people fighting for limited natural resources, causing more international conflict. The good news is we know what we have to do. And what we have to do as a nation is lead the world. This is a global problem, not just an American problem. But we can and must lead the world, work with China, India, Russia, other countries, in transforming our energy system. And when we do that, we can hold our heads up high and tell our kids and our grandchildren, we did the right thing by them. When I talked a moment ago about the international embarrassment of the United States being the only major country on Earth not to provide paid, guaranteed medical and family leave, sick time, vacation time, there is even a greater omission in our country in terms of the rest of the world. Sadly, tragically, the United States remains today the only major nation on Earth that does not guarantee health care to all of its people. I believe that the Affordable Care Act has made some important steps forward. A lot more people now have health insurance, are getting a little bit better handle on skyrocketing health care costs. But at the end of the day, as a nation, we have got to ask ourselves two questions. Number one, should the United States join the rest of the industrialized world in guaranteeing health care?